And now it is my distinct honor to introduce Dr. Jim Willbanks. Dr. Jim H. Willbanks is Professor Emeritus of Military History at the U.S. Army Command and General Staff College. He retired from CGSC in April 2018 after 49 years of combined federal service. For 2 years prior to retiring, Dr. Willbanks served as the General of the Army George C. Marshall Chair of Military History, and he joined the CGSC faculty in 1992 when he retired from the Army as a Lieutenant Colonel with 23 years service as an infantry officer in various assignments, including a tour as an infantry advisor with a South Vietnamese regiment during the 1972 North Vietnamese Easter Offensive. Dr. Willbanks holds a BA in history from Texas A&M University and an MA and PhD from the University of Kansas, and is the author or editor of 20 books, and I am told he is working on 2 more, so try to keep up. He and his work have been highlighted in the New York Times, Los Angeles Times, U.S. News and World Report, Wall Street Journal, Army Times, Stars and Stripes, the History Channel, and PBS. Dr. Willbanks served as a consultant to Ken Burns and appeared on camera in the 10-part, 18-hour documentary on the Vietnam War for PBS. Dr. Willbanks' military awards and decorations include the Silver Star, Legion of Merit, Bronze Star with V and Oak Leaf Cluster, 2 Purple Hearts, and the Vietnamese Cross of Gallantry with 2 Silver Stars. Please help me in welcoming Dr. Jim Willbanks to the stage.
Thank you. Thank you, Camille, for that introduction. I must say, for those of you who know me, know that I left here 2 years ago as fast as I could go south to Texas, with the happiest day of my life was selling my snowblower. And it looks like some of you might be in the market for that now. I'm not. I was welcomed tonight by Darren, who's going to run the cameras up there, and he was very glad to see me, because normally he works with Sean Faulkner, who's my colleague, and I'm sure you've all seen. And I will share with you what one student said in an evaluation about Dr. Faulkner, who said that Dr. Faulkner was the finest instructor he had ever had, military or civilian, but for God's sake, make him stand still. So if you've seen any of his many presentations here, you know he's very active. I'm not, I never was, and now I'm a lot older, so I'll be right here if you need me. I am very pleased to be here tonight because of many of the things I miss about Kansas, and the weather's not one of them. This institution here is one of those things. This is really a national treasure, and I'm glad to be here tonight to help kick off this lecture series and the exhibit that opened last week. My task here this evening is to help set the stage for the presentations that will follow in this lecture series in the coming weeks. When we think about the Vietnam War, many tend to mark the beginning of the war for the United States during the Johnson administration with either first the Tonkin Gulf Resolution or Tonkin Gulf Incident in August of 64, or alternatively perhaps in March of 1965 when the first contingent of U.S. Marines came ashore at Red Beach near Da Nang. However, to understand how the United States first became involved in Vietnam, we have to go back much further in time. It is appropriate that we begin our consideration of the Vietnam War in this magnificent facility that commemorates the Great War, because in a very real sense, the seeds of the American War in Vietnam can be traced back to World War I and the events that followed during the interwar years and after, which set the stage for the First Indochina War that would indirectly and ultimately lead to U.S. involvement in Southeast Asia. It is those events that we will talk about here tonight. However, before we discuss the genesis of U.S. involvement during this period, we need to first consider the situation in Vietnam before World War I commenced. In the latter half of the 19th century, the French began the process of conquering Indochina as part of their grander imperial design for Asia. Over a period of 50 years, as indicated on the slide, at the urging of French business interests and the Catholic Church, the French Army and Navy set about to subjugate the peoples of Southeast Asia. By the late 1880s, this process was almost complete, and the French began the colonization of Southeast Asia for the benefit of Greater France. By 1887, the French had consolidated their hold on the area, forming the Indochinese Union, which included the colonies of Cochin China, Central Vietnam, Cambodia, Tonkin, Northern Vietnam, Annam, Southern Vietnam, and then they would add Laos in 1893. As the colonial bureaucracy flourished, the French colons assumed complete control in a society and culture transplanted to Vietnam from Paris. Because of the top-heavy bureaucracy and its inefficiencies, plus rampant corruption that prevailed in the French administration, the colonies in the beginning operated at a financial loss and proved to be a drain on the French economy. Eventually, however, a new governor general named Paul Dumais arrived to take charge. Determined to put the colonies on a pay-as-you-go basis, he levied taxes on opium, wine, and the salt trade. He seized land from the Vietnamese landholders and gave them to French business interests. He established Indochina as a market for French products, and eventually his programs turned the colonies into a profitable venture, which proved to be a windfall for France. Colonial rule throughout Southeast Asia, or throughout Indochina, was ensured by the presence of French occupation troops. The use of force was the only way that colonial rule could be maintained, and any benevolent ideas that some in the administration had about governing the colony and the mission of civilizing the natives quickly evaporated. Accordingly, French influence permeated nearly all aspects and elements of Vietnamese society and daily life. The French imposed their own standards and values upon Vietnam's traditional society, thereby cutting that society loose from its ancient historical moorings. The result was a colonial bureaucrat's dream. French officials not only administered the colonies, but they also controlled the apparatus that approved funds, granted promotions, and reviewed the colonial bureaucracy itself. The French even controlled the courts, meaning that there was no avenue for the Vietnamese to try to redress any of the excesses of the colonial system. Not surprisingly, there were a number of resistance movements that began to emerge almost immediately. These movements were led by different people and occurred in a number of different locales across Vietnam. However, these movements at this time were ultimately doomed to failure for several reasons. First of all, these movements lacked unity of effort and direction, as you can see by the laundry list of participants. Additionally, most of the movements focused on military action rather than on political efforts to mobilize mass support among the peasantry. And finally, the French military was brutal in putting down any and all native uprisings. Although the early resistance movements failed during this period, they laid a very important foundation for future Vietnamese resistance movements against the French that would ultimately be more successful. Ironically, the events of World War I and its aftermath in Europe would contribute to strengthening the resistance movements against the French in Vietnam. Until the outbreak of the Great War, the total number of Indochinese immigrants in France scarcely exceeded several hundred. But as the war ground on, France began to run into manpower difficulties due to the heavy losses at the front. And the French government turned to its colonial empire, including Indochina, to provide additional workers and troops for the war effort. During the course of the war, over 49,000 civilian workers were transported from Vietnam and Cambodia to France to work in 129 metropolitan establishments to take the place of Frenchmen who were needed at the front. These workers were assigned to a variety of government departments and efforts such as forestry, agriculture, public works, and especially munitions factories. There they demonstrated their ability to work hard. At the Bergerac munitions plant, for example, they contributed 70% of the production while representing only 50% of the workforce there. In addition to the Vietnamese workers, there was a wave of Vietnamese and Cambodian recruits who began arriving in 1915 to augment the French army. By the end of the war, the total Vietnamese troops would top nearly 50,000, bringing the total number of Vietnamese soldiers and workers committed to France during the war to nearly 100,000. The arriving Vietnamese soldiers were formed into infantry companies and sent to the front. Whereas many of the Vietnamese workers were pressed into service as conscripts, many of the Vietnamese recruits were volunteers. One French historian attributed this to the attraction of metropolitan France and the search for adventure on the part of the Vietnamese who agreed to go to France to fight in the war. Additionally, there were a number of inducements in Vietnam to increase recruitment. Among these were bonuses, family allowances, and exemption from certain taxes for those who signed up. Recruitment posters promised prosperity and racial equality, which were both in short supply in Vietnam. At the same time, there were hard times in Vietnam stemming from the floods of 1913 to 1915 in northern Vietnam, and this contributed to the pool of Vietnamese willing to go to the front. Most of the Vietnamese troops did not reach the front until early 1916, thus missing many of the earlier murderous trench warfare episodes on the Western Front. Once at the front, the Vietnamese battalions usually served more as service troops rather than frontline combat units. However, there were some exceptions. Some Vietnamese formations immediately were sent into the line. A good example of this was a unit called the 7th Tonkinese Rifle Battalion, which arrived in April 1917. According to official French military reports, this battalion deployed in the Vosges sector near Linga and held their ground against several German assaults, receiving high marks from the French command. In the bloodletting that was World War I, the Vietnamese troops suffered their share of casualties, and many thousands of Vietnamese and Cambodians died for France, or mort pour la France, as their epitaphs read on the tombstones of those who were buried in France. For those Vietnamese who went to France and survived the fighting, they returned home having been exposed to new ideas. Some of those who had worked in French civilian factories had become radicalized by their contacts with French workers and the French labor movement. They learned the usefulness of trade unions and collective action and received practical experience in organizing labor protest. At the same time, those who served in the French ranks as soldiers were exposed to Western ideas of military discipline, strategy, and tactics. For both the Vietnamese soldiers and workers, they shared some common experiences in France, which changed their outlook on life and their perception about their relationship with the French back home in Vietnam. They came back to Vietnam, changed men, and began to ask questions about the nature of French rule in their homeland. Having fought and supported France in its greatest hour of need, they began to wonder why things couldn't be better for them in their own country. Many of those Vietnamese who returned to Vietnam from France would join a nationalist movement that began to grow in the years following the end of World War I. Among those young men who went to France during the World War I years was one individual who would play a seminal role in the conflict to come in Vietnam. His name was Ho Chi Minh. Ho was born Nguyen Sinh Cung in Nha An province in 1890. As a boy, he studied the writings of the leading Vietnamese nationalist. He attended the prestigious Nationalist Academy in Hue, but he was expelled for political activism. In 1911, taking the name Van Ba, he boarded a steamer for France. In 1912, he departed France, taking another steamer to Boston, ultimately where he worked as a day laborer in New York City for a while. After a stint in New York City, he then took a steamer to London, where he worked as a pastry chef in the Carlton Hotel. As World War I came to a close, Ho crossed the English Channel and went back to France, where he became active in the political activities of various anti-colonial nationalist groups in Paris. In June 1919, world leaders met in Paris to shape the peace following the war to end all wars. Ho Chi Minh and his comrades saw an opportunity to plead their case for independence from France. They hoped to approach President Wilson, whose 14 points seemed to promise self-determination for all peoples. Ho and his comrades drafted a petition to present to Wilson called The Demands of the Vietnamese People. It began, "All subject peoples are filled with hope by the prospect that an era of right and justice is opening to them in the struggle of civilization against barbarism." The petition then listed 8 demands for the French overlords of Vietnam that addressed things such as Vietnamese representation in the French Parliament, freedom of the press, right of free association in Vietnam, freedom of immigration and foreign travel, and the establishment of the rule of law instead of the rule of decree in Vietnam. The petition was signed for the group by Nguyen Ai Quoc, Nguyen the Patriot, one of many aliases that Ho would assume during his political life. Ho bought a morning coat for his audience with Wilson, but he never got anywhere near the American president. It is highly unlikely that Wilson ever saw the Vietnamese petition. It is certain that he did not reply to it. Wilson had talked broadly about self-determination, but he spoke primarily of the peoples dominated by the defeated Central Powers in Austria-Hungary. He did not appear to be willing to grapple with the colonial questions beyond those arising from the war itself. In the months after submitting the petition and having had no reply from Wilson, Ho became more and more radicalized. In December 1920, having come to the attention of French socialists such as Léon Blum, he was invited to the Socialist Party Congress in Tours, where he spoke to the party members but did not gain any support for his ideas about Vietnamese self-determination. Based on the failure of the great powers to address the colonial question seriously from his perspective, and finding no real support in the French Socialist Party, Ho turned to communism and the Bolshevik Revolution as a model for achieving independence. In 1923, he left Paris for Moscow, where he was employed by the Comintern, studied at the Communist University of the Toilers of the East, and participated in the 5th Comintern Congress in June 1924, before arriving in China in November of that year. Ho began a round of travels that would keep him out of Vietnam for a number of years. In the years leading up to the start of World War II, while Ho was away, there was a steady growth of Vietnamese nationalism in his homeland. This took many forms and involved a myriad of factions and even religious sects. One of those factions was the Indochinese Communist Party, which was founded by Ho Chi Minh in Hong Kong in 1930. In the beginning, the Indochinese Communist Party was only one of several groups vying for control of the Vietnamese nationalist movement. By far the strongest in 1930 was the Vietnamese Nationalist Party. Unrest in the countryside had grown due to deteriorating economic conditions, and in 1930, the Vietnamese Nationalist Party led an uprising at Yen Bai, northwest of Hanoi. The French responded strongly to the uprising, and the Vietnamese Nationalist Party was crushed. Other nationalists were forced to underground. This paved the way for the Indochinese Communist Party to begin the assumption of control of the Vietnamese nationalist movement, drawing in more moderate elements who wanted to unite in common cause to oust the French. During this period, Ho kept on the move, spending more time in Russia, then China, then back to the Soviet Union again. Meanwhile, on the other side of the world, a major conflict was breaking out, and it would have a tremendous impact on the future of Vietnam. In September 1939, Hitler and his war machine launched a new war in Europe. By mid-June 1940, France had fallen to the Germans, and they had installed a puppet French government at Vichy. In the Pacific, Germany's ally, Japan, decided to move into Indochina. Doing so would give the Japanese access to raw materials like rubber, tin, and coal, plus vast quantities of much-needed rice. Additionally, Indochina could serve as an advance base for operations against the Far Eastern possessions of the Western colonial powers. On August 20th, 1940, Japan concluded an agreement with the Vichy officials in Saigon that recognized Japan's, quote, preeminent position, unquote, in the Far East. In return, the Japanese recognized the permanent French interest in Indochina. According to this agreement, Japanese troops in Vietnam would be limited to 6,000. However, the Japanese violated the agreement almost immediately when 30,000 Japanese troops moved into northern Vietnam in force. Subsequently, armed conflict erupted between the French and the Japanese. A ceasefire was arranged, and the Japanese apologized for what they called a dreadful mistake. But they had served notice that although the French might still be the titular rulers in Vietnam, they operated at the mercy of the Japanese. Therefore, at the beginning, the Japanese left the French administration in place with the police and security services still in French hands. The Japanese were content to let the French continue the financial burden of administering the colonies while they focused on the war effort. Shortly after the confrontation between the French and the Japanese, Ho Chi Minh, still operating under the name Nguyen Ai Quoc, saw an opportunity developing and secretly returned to Vietnam. He set up operations in a cave near the hamlet of Pak Bo in Cao Bang province in northern Vietnam along the Chinese border. In mid-May 1941, he convened the 8th plenum of the Indochinese Party, Communist Party. During this 9-day meeting, the delegates formed the Vietnam Doc Bloc Dong Minh, the Vietnamese Independence League, or Viet Minh, as they became more popular than known. The Viet Minh attracted many different nationalist groups who united with Ho and the Communists to fight both the Japanese and the French. The Viet Minh set about to organize the peasants in the countryside and at the same time began to train guerrillas to confront the French and Japanese. As the war progressed, the future political status of Indochina became a diplomatic problem for the wartime allies. It was a question tied to the larger issue of the post-war fate of European Asian empires. President Roosevelt was a proponent of self-determination and was opposed to the restoration of colonialism in Asia, but he did not want to anger Churchill, who wanted France to keep its colonies, thereby allowing Britain also to maintain control of its pre-war colonial possessions in Asia. Roosevelt knew that he needed Britain and France for the post-war balance of power in Europe, not to mention to complete the war. So he needed to go slowly on the self-determination issue. Nevertheless, he espoused the idea of an international trusteeship for Vietnam that would prevent the return of French colonialism and provide for the eventual restoration of sovereignty to the Vietnamese people. While the world leaders quarreled over the political future of China, Viet Minh guerrillas carried out espionage missions and raids on Japanese forces occupying northern Vietnam. In December 1944, Ho, who had consolidated his control of the Viet Minh, ordered the creation of the Vietnamese Liberation Army. Under the leadership of Vo Nguyen Giap, the Vietnamese guerrillas gained control of three northern provinces on the Chinese border and engaged Japanese forces in sporadic combat. By early 1945, the war had turned badly for the Japanese. On 12 January 1945, Admiral Bull Halsey's Third Fleet struck Saigon Harbor to destroy Japanese shipping. 500 American fighter bombers hit ships at anchor in the harbor, and those sorting in the immediate area, as well as the oil storage tanks along the Saigon River. In all, 14 Japanese warships and 33 merchant ships were destroyed. One of the largest numbers of enemy ships sunk in any one day during the war. This situation alarmed the Japanese in Vietnam. By this time, the U.S. had landed on Iwo Jima and then the Philippines. The Japanese thought that Vietnam might be the next one on the Allied list for invasion. The French thought this as well, and some in the administration there began to make plans to oust the Japanese. Japanese intelligence got advance notice of what the French were planning and launched a preemptive strike. On 9 March 1945, they quickly disarmed the French army and gendarmerie and incarcerated them along with 750 French civilian colonial administrators. Ho Chi Minh realized that with the French removed from power and the Japanese on the verge of defeat, the Viet Minh were being presented with a unique opportunity. Ironically, he would be abetted in this effort by the United States. On 16 July 1945, a small team of OSS operatives, Special Operations Team 13, led by Major Allison Kent Thomas, jumped into Vietnam to assist the Viet Minh. They would be known as the Deer Mission. The purpose of the mission was to link up with the Viet Minh to secure their assistance in locating and recovering downed U.S. pilots and escaped Allied prisoners of war. When the Deer team parachuted into the Trinh Tao area in northern Vietnam, the team hoped to link up with Ho Chi Minh, who was now calling himself C.M. Hu. They found Mr. Hu sick with malaria, but the team medic treated him and he quickly recovered. Then the American team married up with Giap's army of 200 peasant recruits and they provided the Viet Minh with radios, small arms, ammunition, and some rudimentary training. The OSS were impressed by Ho, and Ho, for his part, cultivated his new OSS friends, hoping that they would assist in getting United States support for his efforts to achieve independence from the French after the war was over. Meanwhile, on the other side of the war, President Roosevelt had passed away. Roosevelt, who had been the main advocate for a trusteeship for Vietnam, was no longer around. Thus, the question of U.S. policy in Southeast Asia that might have been resolved by FDR was left to Truman. For Truman, Vietnam was a diplomatic backwater. He had much larger issues to deal with at this time. Consequently, at the Potsdam Conference in July and August 1945, among those more important issues, Truman and the other Allied leaders agreed that Vietnam would be temporarily divided at the 16th parallel at the war's end. North of the boundary, the Chinese nationalists would take the Japanese surrender. South of the boundary, the British would take charge. They did not, however, specify what would be done with the territory once the Japanese surrendered. That is, who would be given sovereignty after the Japanese troops withdrew. When the Japanese surrendered, following the dropping of the atomic bombs on Hiroshima and Nagasaki, Ho quickly seized the moment. In the void that followed Japanese surrender, the Viet Minh quickly took control of local, district, and provincial governments across Vietnam. During the period 16 to 29 August, Ho created the National Liberation Committee of Vietnam to form a provisional government. And you all may remember that this time, most of the French officials were still in prison. On 2 September 1945, Ho publicly declared Vietnamese independence before 500,000 people assembled in Hanoi's Ba Dinh Square, with the OSS officers from the DEER team in attendance. He began his speech with the words from the American Declaration of Independence, drawn from a copy given to him by Archimedes Paddy, one of the OSS agents in attendance. Having established a new government in Hanoi, Ho Chi Minh wrote 8 letters to President Truman requesting U.S. support and asking for U.S. recognition of the Democratic Republic of Vietnam. Truman did not respond to any of the letters. On 13 September, the British arrived to take the Japanese surrender in accordance with the agreement made at Potsdam. On 21 September, refusing to recognize the Democratic Republic of Vietnam's claim to sovereignty, British General Gracie declared martial law. He ordered all Vietnamese forces disarmed and then released and rearmed about 5,000 French troops the Japanese had interned. During this chaos, the French forces, abetted by General Gracie and its British colonial troops, overthrew the Viet Minh government in place in Saigon. The Vietnamese responded by proclaiming a general strike and ordered counterattacks against the French. Gracie, in a strange move, responded by rearming the Japanese troops to help maintain order in the streets. On 24 September, French General Leclerc and French occupation troops arrived in Saigon. From that point on, the French were firmly in control, at least in the south. In the north, Ho Chi Minh essentially bought off the nationalist Chinese who had arrived to take the Japanese surrender. Meanwhile, he co-opted various Vietnamese national movements to broaden his power base. So that by the beginning of 1946, there were really two governments in being, the Vietnamese and the French. At first, Ho tried to work out a deal with the French. In March, he signed an agreement with Admiral D'Archelieu, French Governor General of Indochina, to allow 25,000 French troops in Vietnam for the next 5 years, with the hopes of eventually gaining full independence for Vietnam within the French Union. Ho's more radical colleagues were very critical of Ho's actions in this agreement. And I will quote here using the earthy language that Ho used. Ho replied to those who were having problems with his approach, quote, "I prefer to sniff French dung for 5 years than eat Chinese shit for the rest of my life," unquote. Ho thought he could reach an accommodation with the French, but he was wrong. The D'Archelieu backpedaled from the 6th March agreement, and it soon became clear that the agreement was largely meaningless. In a final attempt, Ho personally went to Paris in May 1946 to try to work out a peaceful solution to the growing conflict. In the end, this trip achieved nothing meaningful, and on 20 October, Ho departed for Vietnam virtually empty-handed. Soon after Ho returned to Vietnam, an incident occurred that pushed the situation past the point of no return. On 23 November 1946, French and Vietnamese customs officials clashed at the port of Haiphong. The French responded by shelling the city, killing a large number of Vietnamese civilians. And the numbers range in the reports from 3,000 to 30,000, so I guess you can pick the number you like. Nevertheless, these were the first shots of the First Indochina War. On 19 December, the Viet Minh launched retaliatory raids against French installations. And by the end of December, armed hostilities between the French and the Viet Minh guerrillas were fully underway and were escalating rapidly. Ho fled to the remote mountainous area north of Hanoi and began to prepare for the coming fight. Thus began the First Indochina War, which would rage from 1946 to 1954. Ho and the Viet Minh would fight a protracted war that had historical precedent in Vietnam history. As when they resisted Chinese rule in their early years, they had learned that the weak could outlast the strong and ultimately bleed the strong to death in a drawn-out confrontation. However, in this case, at least in the beginning, the French had the edge over the Viet Minh in both manpower and weapons. By 1948, the French were close to defeating the Viet Minh, but the events of the following year would change all of that. In that most momentous year, first, the Soviets exploded their first atomic bomb, thereby setting aside the atomic monopoly that the U.S. had previously enjoyed. Secondly, and perhaps in this case at least, more importantly, Mao and the Communists triumphed over the Chinese nationalists of Chiang Kai-shek. Prior to that time, the United States had largely remained out of the conflict between France and the Vietnamese. However, these events and the developing Cold War between East and West would soon cause the United States to become directly involved in the conflict in Vietnam. Shortly after Mao claimed victory in China, Ho turned to the People's Republic and also the Soviet Union for aid and assistance in the war against the French. The Chinese support would prove the difference on the battlefield. They would provide the Viet Minh military advisors and significant amounts of weapons, equipment, and supplies. Eventually, this support would enable the Viet Minh to achieve near parity with the French in small arms, automatic weapons, and artillery. Meanwhile, events elsewhere would have a major impact on subsequent U.S. involvement in this conflict. As previously stated, of course, the U.S. and the West had become involved in a Cold War that developed in the years immediately following the end of World War II. If there was any doubt that the West was locked into an all-out confrontation with the Communists, that all changed on 25 June 1950 when the North Korean Communists crossed the 38th parallel and invaded South Korea. With a hot war of our own in Korea and Ho Chi Minh appealing for support from Mao, it became clear in policy circles in Washington that stopping the Communists in Southeast Asia was essential, at least in the mind of those decision makers. Accordingly, President Truman signed a bill authorizing $10 million in military aid for French forces in Vietnam. In September of 1950, he ordered the establishment of the U.S. Military Assistance Advisory Group Indochina, or MAG-I as it was known, in Saigon to assist the French, and began to send U.S. troops there in an advisory status. In December 1950, the U.S. signed the Pentilateral Agreement promising further military aid and support to the French in Indochina. Thus, the U.S. entered into an agreement with France to bankroll their war effort in Southeast Asia, essentially paying the French to fight a surrogate war against the Communists in Vietnam while we were engaged in Korea and elsewhere. By the end of 1952, the U.S. was underwriting 40% of the cost of the war in Indochina. By the end of the war in 1954, the U.S. was paying more than 80% of the cost of the war. Despite U.S. assistance, by May 1953, the French were in trouble in Vietnam. They had lost the Tonkin Highlands, north of and west of Hanoi. Laos was threatened and in danger of falling to the Viet Minh. And the war had been extremely costly in terms of casualties. The French had sustained 90,000 killed and wounded in the course of the war to date. Additionally, political support for the war at home was fading rapidly. The French were in a desperate situation strategically. A new commander arrived to try to redress the situation. General Henri Navarre was determined to turn the situation around. He began by launching a succession of small-scale attacks against Viet Minh-held territory in the north and central regions of Vietnam. However, these attacks did not deter Giap and the Viet Minh, who launched a new offensive of their own in December 1953. By the end of December, Vietnam was virtually cut in two at its narrowest point. Navarre realized that something had to be done to stem the tide or the whole situation would be lost. He decided to try to lure the Viet Minh into a set peace battle in which the French forces could bring to bear their superior firepower. He would do so by sending 12 battalions to a village called Dien Bien Phu near the Laotian border in northwest Tonkin. He believed this would lure Giap into committing his forces en masse where they could be destroyed once and for all. Unfortunately for the French, the plan worked only too well. Giap responded quickly, moving 50,000 regular troops and tens of thousands of support personnel to the area, and they rapidly encircled the French defenders of the Dien Bien Phu garrison. The bitter battle raged for 2 months, but at the end, the French were decisively defeated. By the end of the fighting, the French had sustained over 7,000 killed in action, and an additional 11,000 were taken prisoner by the Viet Minh. The war was essentially over at that point for the French. In the wake of this defeat in Dien Bien Phu, the Geneva Accords were signed on 21 July 1954. Under the provisions of this agreement, Vietnam was divided at the 17th parallel, elections were to be held in 2 years, and 300 days was allowed for free movement between north and south. The French forces departed Hanoi on 9 October 1954, and the Viet Minh formally took control of Hanoi on 11 October. At this point, there were essentially two Vietnams, one in the north, led by Ho Chi Minh, and one in the south that would be supported by France and the United States. France would ultimately leave for good in 1956, and this left the Americans alone to work with the Vietnamese government in the south to try to stem the spread of communism. Deeply involved in the Cold War and firmly believing in the idea of containment, decision makers in Washington determined that the U.S. could not afford to walk away and allow the communists to take over Vietnam. Accordingly, three successive administrations steadily increased the commitment of U.S. troops and resources in an attempt to stem the tide of communism. That, in the mind of the decision makers and those administrations, was a direct threat and really was a danger of spreading throughout Southeast Asia and beyond. Over time, the war would evolve from the troops who were advising the fledgling government and military in Saigon to the commitment of U.S. ground forces, and would escalate until the U.S. would commit over 500,000 combat troops to what the Vietnamese called the American War. From the beginnings that we have talked about here tonight, the conflict became the most divisive war in American history, one that resulted in the death of over 58,000 Americans and more than 1.5 million Vietnamese. How and why that escalation happened and the ultimate outcomes of that war will be the subject of later lectures in this series. This completes my presentation. Thank you for your attention. I'll be glad to address any questions you might have.
You are welcome to head down to either mic, and if you're unable to make it, I will come to you with the mic. There we go.
Well, they either answered all your questions or bored you to tears. Either way, the effect appears the same.
One from the back, Jim.
Wave your arms at me. I can hardly see. Hey. There you go.
You briefly touched at the end on our direct involvement in the 60s. Mm-hmm. And I was wondering, how much influence did the Secretary of State McNamara have in the escalation of the conflict on our part?
Secretary of Defense McNamara?
Yes.
You doing anything for the next week? Well, I think, and certainly that will be talked about in subsequent lectures. I think I know that the Nixon strategy, I think a friend Greg Dattis is going to come from California and talk about Nixon. I think someone else is on is going to talk about the Johnson administration. But certainly McNamara played a key role. To McNamara, it appears that Vietnam was a math problem. The only trouble is that that didn't factor in the will of the North Vietnamese, and primarily the Lao Dong Party, headed by Ho Chi Minh in the beginning and Lê Duẩn ultimately. So that's, you know, there are almost as many books about McNamara as there are on the third day of Gettysburg, which is hard to believe. So he played a major role, but we don't have time to go into that here tonight.
So Ho Chi Minh referenced the U.S. Declaration of Independence when he declared independence for Vietnam. Was that just a piece of sort of stagecraft? Did he do that simply because he knew the audience he was talking to, or did he have predilection or knowledge of the U.S. independence movement?
Well, I think yes to all of that. He certainly was an opportunist. He saw an avenue here, perhaps through the OSS. There's about a 1,200-page book about Ho Chi Minh by William Diker that's a tremendous read, but it's very ponderous, that basically says that he was very good at doing whatever he had to do. He could make noises like a nationalist, he could make noises like a communist, but as I'm fond of saying in my classes when I had classes, which I don't, and I'm glad to say that at this point, you had to see what he did. He would make noises like, and there are those who say he was a nationalist, he wasn't really a communist. The patriot who wrote the Vietnamese national anthem that was played on that day in September at the end of the war when the Democratic Republic was proclaimed was later executed during by Ho Chi Minh's forces. He was very good at using whoever he needed to. So I think the idea of parroting the American Declaration of Independence was certainly a ploy that he had an audience. But in that particular case, it was a message sent but not received. You know, and to continue that, he was dead. He died in 1969. But at the end of the war, all of those non-communist nationalist elements that were part of the Viet Cong, the National Liberation Front, they were basically just pushed to the side in favor of the North Vietnamese.
At the microphone.
Yes, sir, Dr. Willbanks. The German historian Jörn Leyenhard has argued that when French society saw troops from West Africa, the French colonies there coming in to France to serve in certain positions, whether in combat or service troops, there was a reaction against them, against seeing them as part of the war effort. Was there anything very similar to that happening when Vietnamese came into France as service troops or as combat troops?
Well, it just kind of depended on what mode they're in. They were more than happy to have the Vietnamese that were doing labor and building the railroads, maintaining the railroads, for instance. Certainly, anybody who could carry a rifle at the front was a plus. The French had a long history of using colonial troops. In fact, many of those who fought at Dien Bien Phu with the French were from Africa, Senegalese, from the Cameroon. So I haven't read anything. I'm sure there were some racial overtones in France from the arrival of all these Vietnamese, but, you know, 100,000 isn't a large number when you talk about what's going on in France during that particular point. So I haven't seen anything that had a tremendous impact. What I see in the research is that the Vietnamese themselves were exposed to French liberalism, if you will, small l, and began to ask the question, if that's true for Frenchmen in France, why isn't that true for what the French called Frenchmen overseas, the Vietnamese, the Laotians, the Cambodians? And they were decidedly not equal citizens. And the question was, why not? If not, why not? And that sort of just fed the seeds of the nationalist movement. Yes, please.
Hi,
Hi.
My question was, you mentioned multiple times contact that Ho Chi Minh actually managed to make with American, didn't do such a good job actually getting to meet American presidents, but did meet with soldiers, met with, presumably while working in New York, in Boston, things like that, would have met with regular Americans. Did that create any dialogue at all, or did we see any movement within Americans or expats or former soldiers working with Ho Chi Minh or against or anything?
No, not really.
Okay.
He was a low-level laborer in New York. You know, he had no contact with any kind of decision makers or, you know, policy leaders or anything like that. I do think that from what I've read, he had a pretty positive idea of Americans, you know, common everyday Americans, whatever that means. but I think there was no contact. For instance, Truman, in some quarters, is vilified because he didn't respond to the letters, the eight letters. But there is a couple of things that you can see. You can look at Marshall, who is his Secretary of State, and Marshall says, you know, basically, he's not for continued French colonialism in Vietnam, but he's also not for turning Vietnam over to a communist, which Ho Chi Minh at that time is decidedly at least wearing the communist T-shirt. I'm not going to go into, was he a nationalist or a communist? I don't have that much time. I got a plane to go back to Texas in the morning. And I'm going to be on it.
Our last question will come from the audience.
Yeah. Good evening. I'm glad you mentioned Duker's book, because I found it was a very interesting book, although it was...
Which one?
Duker's book on Ho Chi Minh. It was very good. And I know it's dangerous to ask about historians, a consensus among historians, but I'm going to do it anyway. Is there a consensus, or what are the sort of leading ideas about what may have happened? What do professionals who look at this believe may have happened if the United States had lived up to the 1954 agreement and held national elections in 1956 and tried a diplomatic approach to dealing with Ho in 1956 as the peace agreement dictated? Or do you think it was a better outcome that the United States threw it out and did not require UN-supervised elections in 1956 in Vietnam?
Well, there are lots of ideas about that in the historiography. I for one, you know, I don't deal in science fiction. I deal in what actually happened. And there were no elections in 56, and the result is we're probably all aware of what happened from that. So what coulda, shoulda, might have happened, I guess it's an interesting intellectual exercise, but really doesn't have any particular endpoint that I can determine. Part of the problem is, and I think the biggest lesson in Vietnam is you need to know who your opponent is, and you need to try to get inside their mind. And that's very difficult because we tend to mirror our own values on those that we're in confrontations with. You know, Johnson says he's going to offer a TVA project to Ho Chi Minh. And he says Ho Chi Minh can't turn that down. The trouble is, Ho Chi Minh's not George Meany. He's Ho Chi Minh. So thank you very much for your attention. Thanks for having me back.
Thank you, folks.